game. And UCCU is like, yep, thanks, Raven Idol. Dionne, look at that smug look on his face. He's like, yeah, I killed him with Starfire.
The last matchup, Rogue versus Patron, they thought that would be easy, but yeah, I think my draws were so bad. Yeah. The other players in our group have the same lineup, so I'll think of a better strategy maybe.
多研究一下牌组，对，因为很对我来讲很重要。
There's no point practicing at this time, so I think I'll just take a good rest.
就谢谢你们支持我，我会更加努力的。Just
keep supporting me, I'll do my best.
Hello and welcome back to the Hearthstone Asia Pacific Winter Championships Day 2. Crazy to think that a couple of hours into the broadcast we're only two games down, but Brian Kibler, that means that it's time for our first elimination match.
Yeah, and this match looks like it'll probably take a little bit less time than the last one. These players both have much more aggressive lineups than what we've seen so far today.
Yeah, both players went down 3-1 in their first series, so it's going to be a big comeback trail, but one player is going to go on to in the tournament. The other player is going to be out, so elimination time means that the stakes are just that much higher. And we want to ask you guys, who do you think will win between Staz and UCCU? Use the hashtags #Staz or #UCCU.
Yeah, and as we were saying, you know, both these players brought much more aggressive lineups. They actually have the only Rogue in the event, as well as the only Shaman in the event. Both of those you know, haven't been quite as popular as these more controlling style of decks here.
And actually, if you think about it, both those decks went 0-2 on the first day. Aggro Shaman couldn't pick up a victory in two choices. The Rogue with lots of interesting tech choices that we'll come back to a little bit on. But let's get this series started. First of all, it's UCCU.
UCCU, the Taiwanese player. He looking to perhaps improve his status in the community, hopes to bring more good results to Taiwan.
Absolutely. Joining Pimping Ho from that Taiwanese region. Pimpo himself just picked up the big reverse sweep. Now we're looking for his Taiwanese brethren to find a big result. Again, really struggled to get involved in his first series. And much the same story for his opponent, it's Staz.
Staz is from the Philippines. He's an engineer, was formerly a professional Hearthstone player for a time, and was waxing about perhaps getting back to that life. So a good result here could perhaps help him do that, but he's got to win this match to do it.
And yeah, both players were talking about not picking up favorable draws in their first series. Staz, as you mentioned, he's kind of the bad luck story. You know, was so unfortunate in not being able to represent at BlizzCon 2 years ago, now trying to stake his claim. Both these players, it's all about this one best of five. One conquest best of five means they either stay in the tournament or go home with nothing.
Yeah, and these are definitely matchups that are going to be a little more explosive than what we've seen. No tank up here. We have, as we mentioned before, two tempo mage decks. We've seen all freeze mage so far today. So mana worms go a little faster than Alexstrasza to end the game.
And it's interesting also, I'm really excited to see the bans when we get around to it, just because there's not necessarily a clear ban on both sides, which could potentially open up some fireworks depending on what we see. Speaking of what we see, we're going to wait to see what you guys thought about these two players. We'll see what the polls say. Imagine it'll be pretty close. Actually, no. Big lead for Staz coming through over UCCU.
We actually saw the same thing yesterday. Staz seems to have quite a few supporters back at home.
And a big fan base.
Yeah.
It's a good thing. UCCU going to have to overcome the fans at least. But the classes, I think, and the bands are going to tell us a lot about how this series goes. Is there anything before we go to the classes? In fact, we're going to see them right
here
now.
Here they are. And this is kind of what I was thinking that we would see from UCCU. He is banning the Warlock. That the Zoo Warlock, the aggressive Warlock from Staz, definitely matches up very well against the Shaman, as well as potentially the Druid that he's bringing over there.
And a bit understandable to see Staz ban away the Mage, given that thinking that's a bad matchup for some of his decks, the Druid in particular.
Yeah, the Tempo Mage is generally a, and also the Shaman, one of the reasons people bring those decks is to beat Druid, and that's clearly a feature of Staz's lineup as well.
And speaking of the lineups, the guarantee we're thinking is a lot less control. No Freeze Mages, no Murloc Paladins. Theoretically, this should be a fast, explosive series compared to the Slugfest that we've had.
Yeah, I think we're going to get a lot less time here at the desk than D2 and Doa just did, but it's going to be a good one.
We'll have to enjoy it then.
Yeah, exactly.
First time getting to cast with you, but we're going to load in to our first elimination match. It's going to be a really exciting one between these two.
I mean, this is a big match for both these players. You know, both of them coming to represent both themselves and their regions. You know, definitely wanting to put Taiwan and the Philippines more on the Hearthstone map.
And that's been the story from both all three representatives of those countries, Pimpinho and Ho as well, looking for their regions to grow. And certainly a winner in the APAC Winter Championship would qualify in building a scene around the celebrations for that player.
Yeah, absolutely. And it has been interesting to see how the metagame for this tournament has broken down. Most of the other players, as we mentioned, have generally brought fairly controlling strategies, though both of these players are here with much more aggressive lineups.
The holdouts to the aggressive strategy, to the controlling strategy, are these two aggressive players. So looking for fireworks as our first match between Staz and UCCU. Staz going to be starting with the Druid. It's going to be Patron Warrior from UCCU.
Yeah, UCCU's Warrior deck had been banned in his previous match, so we hadn't seen it yet. We had surmised that it was very likely Patron Warrior because the lineup that he brought seemed to largely target Druid decks. And that's exactly the matchup he has here. So the Patron Warrior deck, the goal of Patron Warrior against Druid is to use your weapons and your minions to generate a tempo advantage where you can. The strongest plays the Patron Warrior deck can make against Druid are to make a significant number of patrons, Grim Patron, in the middle turns of the game. That makes it very difficult for the Druid deck to deal with all of them.
The three-card combo I remember from when this matchup was all the rage was Deathspite being equipped on turn four, attacking in Grim Patron, which we see in the hand, but crucially the inner rage to pull off a turn five combo. It might have to be turn six, but certainly options are plenty for UCCU. This seems like a pretty damn strong early game hand.
Yeah, that Grim Patron draw for UCCU was an excellent one because it does allow him to potentially set up that curve of Deathspite into Grim Patron into Whirlwind. Oh, and actually the Drake Corsair draw just there. Struggling to find the guy's name sometimes.
That's okay. You know.
The Pirate. I think of it as the Pirate, you know, the Weapon Pirate. There's actually all Weapon Pirates.
The most played pirate, you'd have to
think. It is actually kind of funny. He is the most played pirate. Poor Captain Greenskin.
Captain Greenskin, when it's played, it seems like it's played from the monkey, and that's
awesome
about it.
Sometimes.
You're right.
But yeah, Staz now, he has a couple of choices here. He does have Innervate, as well as the coin, which gives him a lot of potential options. Looks like he is going to fire off that Innervate to play one of the three seven-cost minions in his hand. I would expect to see either Dr. Boom or the Ancient. It does look like it is going to be the good Doctor who comes down. And he does have, UCCU does have the ability to clear off this board with his Deathspite and the Dread Corsair if he does attack both of them in. That would, however, not necessarily give him the opportunity to use his Whirlwind.
Let's talk about Grim Patron into attacking into the Dr. Boom. As you mentioned, they could trade, but it's one of those scenarios where you could get really lucky with the Boom Bots or you could get really unlucky. Given that he has Whirlwind in hand, do you take pace? Do you slow down? Or is this a turn where you can really feel like going aggressive?
It looks like UCCU is actually just going to go with the Slam, and that allows him to keep his Dread Corsair potentially. He could have taken the risk here. There's actually a couple of opportunities he had to sort of take a little bit of a risk here. If he played the Frothing Berserker first, he would have been able to get a huge attack boost to that Frothing Berserker based on all the damage that was dealt by the Whirlwind effect.
It felt like he didn't take the risk with the Patron, then he didn't take the risk with the Frothing Berserker. The result is significant face damage and just the 2-4 Frothing Berserker. Do you like this lineup? It seems very defensive.
It's definitely a reactive play here. He just wants to ensure that nothing goes disastrously wrong with those Boom Bots. So right now, he is kind of handing the initiative over to Staz here with not a particularly powerful board. And I imagine we'll actually see, I'm somewhat surprised that we're seeing the Ancient of Lore here, since the Ancient of War would represent the ability to stop this board from UCCU immediately.
And we could come back to the previous turn. It was very clear that UCCU didn't have Execute. Mm-hmm. Most likely would have used it on the Dr. Boom, so felt like the 5-10 body would have been very, very difficult to push through, but yeah, have to follow the logic here.
The Slam here does give UCCU the ability to pump up that Berserker as well as take out the Ancient, and now he's actually pushing a ton of damage with this Corcoran Elite.
And you look at next turn, if both these minions live, Whirlwind is lethal on its own. In fact, it's lethal on the board, but even if he's able to heal up with something like Ancient of Law, we'll be able to push enough damage.
Ancient of War from Staz this turn would represent a pretty big wall for UCCU to get through, but right now that would be, if he did play the Ancient, we could see if it was Patron Whirlwind, there'd be four minions. He could actually get through the Ancient with just the Whirlwind and the Frothing Berserker.
Crazy to think, just because of the amount of minions that'll be alive. So Execute also would be the end of the game. Speaking of minions, okay, can't play everything, only has access to 7 mana. Armorsmith would have been another body to buff up the Frothing Berserker.
Yeah, so UCCU here, he has a number of options. I would expect to see the Grim Patron plus Whirlwind, simply because that gives him a clean way to get through this Ancient of War. There'd be 4 minions in play. The Whirlwind deal 4 damage. So the Frothing Berserker would gain plus 4 power, goes to 9. There's 10 health on the Ancient. It lines up perfectly.
All right, well, we're going to see that play. Whirlwind comes through.
And this allows the Korkon Elite to punch through as well. And it's going to put Staz down to just 4 life, facing down 3 minions. And Druid in general can tend to suffer to deal with this kind of board. And I don't really see great options for Staz here. The Force of Nature is an excellent draw, though. It does allow him to at least remove 2 of those. The problem is, that's 2 of them, and there's still a Grim Patron remaining.
He wouldn't be dead on board, but certainly not very far away from that. Full combo would have been enough, but of course, 1 mana short.
Yeah, if Staz had found an opportunity to play Wild Growth earlier, he would be able to use Force Roar to clear this board. And that's actually one of the ways that Druid can deal with the Patron Flood that the Grim Patron deck is capable of generating.
And one of the later cards that's come into Grim Patron has been the Korkon Elite, you know, the Charge 4-3. Cards like that remove turns for things as passive as a Wild Growth. So just never had the breathing room in the matchup to be able to play that card. And now is in this really unenviable situation where, not going to be dead on board, but not far from it.
It's interesting because Staz, he chose to play the Ancient of Lore when he could have played Ancient of War earlier. And if he developed the larger minion before UCCU had a chance to develop more of a board himself, it's possible that he would have been able to be in a position where he survives here because he's just taken less damage.
Well, it's going to be the Treants taking away 2 of the Grim Patrons, but one certainly survives, pushes life total up to 5. Basically, any sort of buff card.
Yeah, Inner Rage wins the game, any weapon wins the game. And Fireworks, that's a weapon, that wins the game. So UCCU will take a quick 1-0 lead over Staz in this elimination match.
And look, turn 8, based on your laddering decks, might not be the quickest of wins, but by the meta that we've seen at the Hearthstone APAC Winter Championships, this is basically just completely a face hunter turn 4 game.
That was about 20 turns faster than the last game we saw, I think.
Yep, no sign of fatigue, more than 10 cards in each person's deck. This is what we get when the deck lists from Staz and UCCU match up.
Yeah, there's definitely a much more aggressive lineup for both players than we've seen pretty much from anyone else in this tournament. Most of this metagame has been very control heavy. Otherwise, you wouldn't see Murloc Paladin everywhere.
That's true. And the Patron Warrior takes out the Druid. It was to be expected. It's a favor matchup, even with the changing nature of Grim Patron after the Warsong Commander changes. So 1-0 up goes Staz. But for now, let's get some more information about Staz from the Philippines.
Hi, I'm Staz. I'm 25 years old from the Philippines. I'm a product engineer in Cypress. It's an American semiconductor company. In 2014, I used to play Hearthstone full-time. You can wake up anytime you want. You can sleep whenever you want. Yeah, it's pretty good. And there's no pressure at all. Maybe just winning the big tournaments. But going full-time, it's pretty relaxing. I miss that life. On my early Hearthstone days, I was just playing casually. I saw a tournament online, decided to join. I did great. Then, yeah, at the end of the year, I got qualified for the BlizzCon qualifiers. Unfortunately, my visa got denied and I wasn't able to come. I was pretty upset, but being upset won't do anything, so I just decided to move on. Pretty much, I wasted a huge opportunity. Fortunately, this time, my visa got approved. Then I was able to come here and participate again. Got a chance for BlizzCon. I was really happy. I was able to go here. This is actually my first time in the US. My first time I got into a plane. Yeah, pretty lucky to have a second chance. I'm Staz. I'm gonna do it for the Philippines.
Staz definitely one to know adversity, talking again about his visa being denied 2 years ago. Finds himself in a hole, 1-0 down, but still very early in this series.
Yeah, he said he misses the life of Hearthstone pro play, you know, not much stress. Well, this is a stressful situation for him right now. He is down a game in a elimination match.
Elimination match, a card game. Elimination match in any situation is going to be about as high pressure as Hearthstone comes. It's certainly not the relaxed lifestyle of laddering that, of course, you're used to for the majority of the season. So finds himself in a hole. That's going to be the Patron Warrior gone. Shaman and Druid left here for UCCU. How do they stack up against the deck list? Because the Rogue in general seems like it's going to struggle.
I think the Rogue is a weak spot for Staz in this particular matchup. It can beat the Druid deck. It depends how things go.
And the operative word there is can.
Yeah, right. I don't feel like the Rogue is likely to be favored in either of these matchups. The Rogue deck, and particularly the version of Rogue that we've seen Staz bring to this event, can often struggle to deal with very aggressive decks. In particular, that aggro Shaman, you know, he doesn't really have much healing. We actually saw his entire deck in his last match. He actually went to fatigue and ran out of damage sources. He has only one copy of Earthrending Farseer, one copy of Antique Healbot, and that can, you know, give him some trouble staying alive against Doomhammer.
I mean, it's interesting because we compare it to probably the most prominent Rogue deck that we've seen in the Hearthstone Winter Championship Tour, and that was Amnesiac, who ran no heal at all. But I believe it was double Sludge Belcher,
yes.
So effective healing, you know, with the taunt versus true healing. Hard to say really where it goes, but certainly been very aggressive Oil Rogue decks. They're going to really struggle against the consistent damage from specifically the Shaman.
Yeah, the Shaman and the Druid both have the ability to kind of close the game out. But this is actually going to be a matchup that should be good for Staz.
Absolutely.
The Tempo Mage is a deck that players bring to tournaments specifically against Druid. The Tempo Mage deck, as its name would suggest, relies on tempo of early minions to create windows of opportunity for them to get a lot of damage in. And one of the most important cards in this matchup is Mirror Entity. Decks like Druid that have a lot of large mid-range minions are very vulnerable to Mirror Entity because it can create huge tempo swings where they can't really afford to play a minion for fear of just giving their opponent a copy.
The removal of things like Flame Cannon and Frostbolt do a lot of work, so certainly a lot of strong cards, but it's a very slow start from Staz unless he draws into something to really get him going.
Yeah, this is just not a good draw from Staz. The Tempo Mage deck really needs those early minions to actually get the pressure on. If you don't have something like the Mana Worm, Mad Scientist, or the Sorcerer's Apprentice, you don't really have any pressure going on, and you really need to do that before the Druid gets to the mid-game and can start playing its larger minions without any real threat.
And that's the thing, is that the Druid, how often in this Tempo Mage versus Combo Druid matchup are you free to Wild Growth on turn two, having taken basically no damage, no board to face off against?
And Staz drawing just big minion into big minion on his third turn. UCCU is actually going to be the first one on the board with this piloted Shredder, and that is not the position that Tempo Mage wants to be in.
Certainly not riding off Staz. You can potentially go off with a card like the Flame Waker in later turns, but very, very slow start. No way to bluff at being Freeze Mage, of course, given that the Tempo Mage was already confirmed yesterday. Ooh, it's an Arena Special. Spiteful
right,
Smith.
Spiteful Smith is actually pretty good for Staz here. It's bigger than the piloted Shredder, can survive both the Shredder and, you know, likely trade with what comes out. But UCCU does have the ability to make a bear here and defend his Shredder and just go face.
Big board facing down, and Staz just desperately looking for a card. I mean, there's a card he would have loved on turn one.
Yeah, that guy is not on time. Mana Worm, what you want to be doing in the first couple turns of the game, still okay here. If Staz does get the opportunity to use his Mana Worm alongside a couple of spells, he can now Frostbolt to take down that bear and potentially attack into Shredder. Kind of take out a bit of UCCU's board, but that's still not the advantage position he's really like to be in.
He's not even going to get a clean board despite investing into two removal spells. So even the possibility that something will pop out of the Shredder to face off against the Mana Worm. So definitely not the big tempo players. And we talk about tempo, about taking advantage of low-cost spells. Staz is basically using them as emergency removal rather than the proactive plays we're used to in this match.
Yeah, one of the reasons that Tempo Mage isn't as popular as some other decks is because it kind of has this problem. It has this conflicted identity of these cards that are, you know, some of them are okay in certain circumstances, but you really need them in the right order in order for them to actually be effective. Here that Bone Guard Lieutenant. I always want to say Boneyard Lieutenant. I don't know if he's like runs the military drills, the Boneyard or whatever, but Bone Guard Lieutenant. That can trade with the Mana Worm or the Spiteful Smith here. So it is a position for UCCU. He's in an okay spot.
Looks like he might want
innervate.
To.
Innervate? Oh, dear. This is huge. This Innervate draw allows him to Innervate. Oh, he actually chooses not to do it. He could have Innervated and coined and used Swipe to clear the entire board.
This was obviously his original line, was to coin into the draw. But as you mentioned, he had the potential to Innervate further, didn't. Is there anything about his hand that really suggests why he didn't invest in the Innervate? Because we just came out of a series where we talked about the fact that the value of Innervate goes down as you get closer and closer to that 10 mana.
Right, at this 7 mana turn that he's going into, there's not a huge value of that Innervate, and he would have had the ability to still have that additional minion in play, and Tempo Mage doesn't play very well from behind. When it's in a position where the opponent is the one with a lot of large minions, it can struggle. Though right now, we may see that Innervate come in handy. UCCU can now play that Azure Drake if that secret is Mirror Entity.
Which we know it is.
Which we know it is. It'll trigger it. Oh, okay. Now,
Now he's really probably
expecting. Well, by attacking first, he gives Staz his second secret, which is Counterspell. So now he actually can't play a minion and then Innervate into Swipe because Staz now has Counterspell up.
Potentially just a sequencing error on the side of UCCU. Yeah. He's going to lead with the Innervate.
Yeah, so the Innervate, now he can play a minion. He might want to play a small minion like that Mind Control tech.
Okay.
Which will give Staz a Mind Control tech, and now he's playing the Swipe.
So is he just getting around a misplay, or is this actually the best way to play out the turn?
This is a way to play the turn that eliminates your opponent's, both of your opponent's secrets. I feel like if he had played Azure Drake and then used the Innervate and Swipe, he would have left his opponent in a situation where he had Counterspell up, but UCCU had dealt with the board in a much stronger fashion.
Staz just ends up playing this particular minion here just as a body, a 5-7 body coming through.
Yeah, Archmage Antonidas is a very powerful finisher in a lot of matchups, but here he's just looking to soak damage. He doesn't play very well from behind, as Tempo Mage tends to do, as we were saying. Here, yeah, UCCU has the opportunity to just clear this with Swipe plus Keeper. He could have traded his board in and played Dr. Boom, but this allows him to continue keeping up the pressure, and I think that's a better position for him to be in.
There's so many matchups where we talk about Druid keeping a big board just to get that Savage Roar lethal, and that's still the case here. Savage Roar would represent lethal damage, and Staz, he has options this turn, but seems like he's going to start reaching when it comes to discovering a spell.
And he finds another mirror image. None of these are really great here. He would have loved to find something like Frost Nova that he could have potentially at least bought a little bit of time with here because he's really far behind.
What about Mana Worm into double mirror image just because you'd have the four taunts on the board when it comes to buying time?
Yeah, I mean, that does buy a little bit of time. It will force UCCU's minions to attack into it, and that is what he selects. So he's able to generate a bit of a board here. But unfortunately, it doesn't really buy that much time because UCCU already has so much board presence already.
Just swipe the previous turn, so it doesn't have the clean kill.
Emperor Tharsin, not really the greatest with this kind of hand from UCCU. I imagine we'll see. He's actually going to go with Ancient. I think he's probably looking to just try and assemble the Savage Roar combo.
Seemed like the first thought would have been Dr. Boom.
My thought here is that Dr. Boom just generates the most immediate pressure. UCCU is so far ahead right now, generally speaking, as you know, those three minions, super far ahead in life, that I think just generating as much board presence as possible right away, and that's what UCCU ultimately decides. He just wants to go ahead and get that Dr. Boom and his Boombox on the board.
So we're looking for something really big off the top for Staz. He's going to still have both minions, including the buffed up Mana Worm, and the slightest amount of protection in the one health mirror image.
Flame Cannon, well, it's a lot of options for it to hit. Staz does have that second Conjurer. He could dig deep and see what he can find. He also has the ability. Oh, he's just going to go with Ragnaros. That is a bold move here. Just, I guess hoping that Ragnaros hits Dr. Boom?
I mean, he's trying to trade in some of his frustration with his starting hand for some immediate luck, as far as I can tell. Let's see where Rag hits.
It does
hit the Dr. Boom. Wow.
Oh, Ragnaros, the sniper, takes down Dr. Boom, and suddenly, this game looks a lot different.
Wow.
That was huge. I mean, Staz was in an enormous deficit. And he may have thought that, okay, I'm so far behind, I just have to get lucky to win here. And UCCU able to rebuild a bit here with that Ancient of Lore. And he's just going to go ahead and send his face into the mirror image. Where does that Boombot go? Face? All right.
Continues to push a lot of damage. Got Staz down to dead on board. 9 damage showing already. Something from the Conjurer
might have something to say about
that. Well, that's true.
He's been doing pretty well so far.
But there's so many ways for UCCU to generate more damage from hand. We know that he only has 2 reach from the Keeper of the Grove right now.
Yeah, this is going to be a terrifying situation. You're playing as Druid. You're at 9. You have not seen any Force of Nature's, any Savage Roar. It's just like, oh, how could I possibly win? But UCCU, he doesn't right now have the way to finish the game off.
This feels like Conjurer and looking for something.
I expect Conjurer may come
leads
down.
Leads with the Flame Cannon.
Flame Cannon and... Oh boy. Boom out of the face.
Well, it's time for something from the Discover.
And this is literally relying on Ragnaros hitting Ancient of Lore. Staz is at 6 health. If he does not hit Ancient of Lore attacks his face. Hero power attacks face. It gets it
gets
again!
Gets it again. This Rag is a sniper.
Seriously,
Kibler.
Ragnaros is not messing around.
Does not draw into anything that would represent lethal.
I mean, he has Ancient of Lore here. If he finds a single copy of Force of Nature, just that closes the game. He doesn't need the combo. He just needs a little bit of damage. So I would... Oh, he's actually just going to go ahead and play the Shredder. Jeez.
The Piloted Shredder.
And fire the face. No, he's debating this again. I think he's just trying to figure out, okay, you know, what sort of damage can I assemble on this board?
And I want to return to Yolan. You were talking about playing the lore. The big thing is that Staz has used both Ethereal Conjurers. Mm-hmm. We're very, very heavily suspect he's not running Ice Spot. That's not a standard card at all. And Tempo Mage, he really has no way to buff up his health total from 6. So digging into things like Druid of the Claw, digging into things like a second swipe, seem like the most guaranteed way to find a win.
A lot of cards here that he could draw off Ancient of Lore that would come close to guaranteeing lethal.
He is also at 32 health to a 2-card Tempo
Mage. That's true. Well, Staz has had some miracle Ragnaros shots so far.
All right,
does he
have
a miracle
curse?
Unstable portal?
What do you want to see? What is
it? I mean, I want to see Deathwing.
Well,
that's close to Deathwing. It can kill a minion right away.
Now, with the ping, he can actually take out the first half of the Piloted Shredder.
He can, yeah, absolutely.
So he is in a position to once again not be dead on board.
Well, he needs to use his Conjurer to attack into the 2-4, the Keeper of the Grove. Use the Knight and Ping to clear off the Shredder. And then Ragnaros has to hit what comes off the Shredder, unless it's something like Lore Master Cho or some other zero power, one power thing. Oh, well,
no spells in hand.
That's currently lethal.
Staz has been living on a prayer for multiple hands. Kills the mana. Still so many cards.
There's one of them. Force of Nature. So Staz is living on borrowed time. That time is over. Force of Nature closes things out, and UCCU is up 2-0.
Staz still emotes the well played. He was living on a prayer for, what, 3-4 turns after such a slow start in a matchup. Again, you bring Tempo Mage to hunt the combo Druid wasn't a reality for Staz this time.
That was really highlighted the problems of Tempo Mage. Tempo Mage really is reliant on getting that early game pressure, because when they don't, their deck is just full of these cards which are kind of inefficient, don't really push the game state in their favor unless they're actually able to be pushing pressure on board.
And there's low pressure Tempo Mage starts, and there's a Druid able to pass turn 1, play Wild Growth turn 2, and get the first minion out on turn 3.
Yeah, UCCU had a great draw, and Staz just, it didn't come together for him. He was saying in the video we saw that, you know, the cards just didn't go his way, and there they definitely didn't.
Staz maybe has reason to be frustrated, but not out of it yet. We just saw a reverse sweep by Pimping Ho, so miracles can come true. But for now, let's get to know our Taiwanese representative, UCCU, who's in such a great spot, a little bit better.
我叫 UCCU， 然后我现在住在台湾，然后24岁。我很喜欢台湾，因为台湾是一个非常棒的地方，它的东西非常的好吃，然后还有夜市。在台湾觉得很好笑，就说哈哈哈，你看看你 ，and then， 所以说我就取了这个 ID 这样子。因为我现在算是没有工作，我就是早上起来吃个饭打炉石，然后吃午餐打炉石，然后晚餐打炉石跟 Overwatch， 然后就结束这一天了。其实那只猫是在台中念书的时候捡到，然后它会站在荧幕前面，然后有时候甚至会占领我的键盘，不让我玩滑鼠之类的。我就会说喊哪，然后就把它弄走之类的。可是它过没多久又会回来这样子。它又很凶，然后爪子又很长，不过它还是一只蛮黏人的猫这样子。这只就是哈娜的杰作 ，Like This。我会希望说，像台湾现在电竞产业刚发展的，我希望它如果以炉石来讲，我希望它可以达到跟韩国一样的境界，是说之后能有更多的比赛在台湾出现这样子。其实一开始在比赛的时候，家人并不知道我在干什么。然后结果后来我打进冠亚区的时候，然后我跟他们讲说我要出国了，然后他说真的假的要出国了，然后他们才慢慢知道说原来这个玩这个东西可以出国，然后可以有一个好的发展这样子，然后他们后来就蛮支持我的。因为现在好不容易有一个亚太区可以打啊，这个是算是我目前来讲最大的比赛了。然后希望自己可以打出一点名声出来，然后当然为国争光。我觉得台湾在亚洲区算强的 ，America is the best region。卡帕。大家好，我是 UCCU 啊，这次我代表台湾到亚太区做比赛。那这次的比赛我会全心尽力，希望我可以把冠军带回台湾。
Well, Brian Kibler, I choose to believe that Hana's sitting at home in Taiwan with those big wide eyes, with eyes of contentment, because UCCU really had a fast start this series. And speaking of short series, compared to the other ones we've seen, and honestly, with one of these players being eliminated,potentially the shortest series of the whole tournament is going to come here because the control wars from the other six players are real.
I mean, this entire series could be shorter than one of the games that we just saw in the last match. So, you know, though Staz isn't out of it yet, he still has opportunities to pick up some wins and keep alive in this tournament.
Well, let's check in on what the fans are thinking. Go back to the poll that we saw earlier, and we're looking like Staz is going to be the comfortable favorite still.The fans, I feel like they're not updating their thoughts. They're just voting with the heart rather than necessarily voting with the results. Because you'd think with 2-0 up, 3 match points, people will be there for UCCU, but not so far.
Well, Cats can't vote.
That's true.
And so he kind of loses some of his support, at least.
To be fair, Hana seemed to at least be interested in the mouse. Like they mentioned that he always gets there.
Definitely interested in Hearthstone, sitting there, you know, not necessarily watching, but maybe she's, you know, hoping that...
The cat is always watching.
It's true.
What it's watching, we're not 100% sure.
Well, she's definitely tempered UCCU for battle here with those scars.
That's true. And those scars, so far, doing him all right. Doing him all right with just one more deck.To win with, to go through, of course.
UCCU has that aggro shaman. That's his last remaining deck.
The only deck he has not picked up a victory with yet.
It's true.
0-2 with aggro shaman yesterday was one of the banes of that first series.
He had incredibly close game.
Sure.
Against the warlock of Dainee. He actually had Dainee down to just one life when Lotheb prevented that ancestral knowledge from digging him into the lightning bolt.That was waiting for him if Lotheb had not been there. But here, it will be Shaman versus Tempo Mage.
And you have to think, as we see the elemental destruction in the starting hand, it's one of the tech choices from UCCU. We have to remember, Staz has to win with all decks, and one of those decks is the Oil Rogue that we have forecast to really struggle in this matchup. So obviously he needs to win with all his decks, but there's uphill battles, and there's this particular battle.
This is a much better draw than Staz had in his just last game, if only because there's that Mana Worm in it. Not only does he have Mana Worm, but those removal spells that he has are very effective in this matchup. If Totem Golem comes down, usually one of the most threatening minions from the Shaman deck, Staz has that Flame Cannon waiting to get rid of it right away.
Doesn't even have to blink. You know.
Oh, dear, a second Mana Worm. If Staz didn't have the draws coming together last game, they definitely are now able to fire off Mana Worm into Coin Flame Cannon and take this out. We do see the Elemental Destruction in UCCU's hand. Can't cast it next turn, though.
That's the thing. He has the perfect answer, but not going to be able to cast it next turn. Now he's going to kind of want to wait for turn 5 to combo it with Lava Shop, because otherwise, with the massive overload from the ability, you're not able to use your next turn at all, but this is already a very imposing board, and as you mentioned, night and day in terms of starting hands for Staz.
Yeah, last game he basically had nothing going on. He had no minions in play and cast Arcane Intellect in turn 3, and right now he has 2 3-3s that are just going to get bigger.
So what you're saying is he went from having nothing going on to having it all going on.
I think Staz saved it all up for this game. But UCCU, he has a couple of options here. I would expect to see, well, he could go ahead and fire off the Ancestral Knowledge. Because if he is planning to wait until turn 5 with that Elemental Destruction, then he really isn't going to do all that much next turn. He just wants to dig deeper into his deck.
But we just saw a game where Staz had to wait to get his combos off, eventually managed to clear the board, but not enough. Now UCCU has two very desirable turn 5 plays. Oh my goodness!
Look at that draw!
Well,
oh my god. So, Genjutsu Auctioneer is pretty good in spell-heavy decks like Miracle Rogue. It's even better when it costs 3 and all your spells cost less. Staz is just about to start going off next turn.
To be clear, his spells cost 0 and 1 respectively, because yeah. I don't know if we're going to see this Sorcerer's Apprentice actually die this turn.
Also worth noting that UCCU is at 19. Staz already has 11 power in play. He could draw cards. He might just win the game next turn.
Does choose to use Lava Shock. Gives him access to 2 more mana. So finally some removal comes through. Now, the big thing about this is he is going to be using the Lightning Bolt, so Doomhammer's still not available to him on turn 5.
Yeah, and Staz, though, he can play the Auctioneer. He can no longer play the other spells at the same time because that Sorcerer's Apprentice did die. So he could Auctioneer into Arcane Missiles if he really wanted to, but right now he could just Frostbolt that Tunnel Frog and just head to the face.
Okay, so two different lines of play.
He could use Arcane Missiles because there's a 50% chance that he gets at least 2 hits on the Tunnel Frog and just uses his ping to get rid of it. As I think the Frostbolt's likely to be a more powerful card in most situations later on. We'll just see what he does. He's actually just going to attack with that. Ooh, okay.
He's going to guarantee that the 3 missiles go to face. Remember, it's quite hard for Aggro Shaman to deal 1 damage from hand. Wants to be using all that burn on the face. So it's still a 5-1 minion, which has to be respected. And there's the Flame Waker off the top as well.
I would not be surprised to just see that Elemental Destruction get fired off right now from UCCU. That Gadget Zen Auctioneer is terrifying. You're playing against a deck. We were just talking about how last game Staz had a handful of nothing but spells. Well, if he has nothing but spells this game, he's just going to find the rest of his deck.
And there's a life total of 16 here. That's definitely a precarious one when you have 9 damage facing. So has to use Elemental Destruction. Had to use the Lava Shock previous turn, so yep. Doesn't have the ability. He only has access to 1 mana next turn.
Yeah, and UCCU picks up that Shapeshift. That goes very well with Doomhammer, but it's not clear how much time he's going to have to be able to actually get Doomhammer set up, because Flame Waker coming down for Staz.
Let's be real. Minimal time, Brian Kibler.
Oh, yes.
I mean, down to 14 already. 1 mana. Can just use Rockbiter Weapon this turn.
Second Doomhammer. That's not very good here. He's just going to have to pass things back over. Overloaded for 5 this turn.
We know that Arcane Insight represents 2 damage and drawing of cards. All right, here we go.
Starting with Unstable Portal. What's in the box? It is, well, I think UCCU might be a little jealous of this Unbound Elemental. Kind of ironic on the wrong side of the table.
Here's the Arcane Insight. Keeps pushing damage. That's the second Flame Waker. No more spells, so no chance of pushing him down to 2 this turn.
UCCU down to just 8 life. He does have Doomhammer plus Rockbiter. He could clear both of these minions from the board. He's just going to go face.
Well, I guess he decides to
he's just going to hope here.
It's some catharsis, well, I think.
The thing is that UCCU, if he's going to win this game, I think he's hoping maybe he can pick up another Rockbiter next turn to maybe actually close things out. But we see that that's not going to happen. Even if he did draw it, he couldn't cast them because Lotheb comes down. And it is! Oh my god, if it weren't for Lotheb, he'd be able to attack for like 20-something damage?
Would have been plus 6 from the Rock Bites plus the Hero Power.
Yeah, so
it would have been
plus 7.
18 damage from
so it wouldn't quite close things out, but no chance for that. UCCU will concede. Staz picks up a game.
And we talk about this story of getting the right cards in the wrong order. Well, they just took turns. They basically did an about face. Everyone got a chance to get their cards in the wrong order. But the result is only a single game win for Staz, who definitely has a match, a lineup that we predicted to struggle to get a 3-0 to sweep this Aggro Shaman. Also worth saying,
what was Staz at the end of that game? I think it was at 24. I think he actually, with Rockbiter, Hero Power, plus Arcane Golem.
22 damage.
It's 22?
This would be plus 7 from the double Rockbiter and the Hero Power, so that's 18 damage.
Yes,
and
it's 18. It's 22. It would have been too short. Even if he hadn't been low theft, he would have been 2 damage short of actually winning that game.
2 damage
short.
So
close, though.
To come back from where
given
he was.
That situation.
Given the situation. Given the tapestry of that game where it looked like he basically thrown it out earlier. You know, he could have seen a concede on turn 5 or 6 and been like, okay, this isn't going to be the game. I'll come back later. But the burst potential of an aggro shaman can never be in doubt.
That's real.
So, getting a win with these two decks, Druid and Rogue. Now, he has to get a win with both. Do you build the confidence with the Druid, which is certainly not a trivial matchup, or do you just go in with the Rogue and just see if it's your day?
I think both of these matchups are going to be pretty tough. The Aggro Shaman deck can get out very quickly against the Druid, and similarly against the Rogue. The fact that the Rogue has to use its life total, its health, as a resource in order to remove minions with its weapon is really costly against Aggro Shaman. As we see, just how much burst it's capable of in that last game.
I mean, some of the tech choices, the two healing cards, they'll be helpful, but no Taunt. Worth noting that the probably won't find a spot to play the Assassin's Blade, you know, for 5 mana when he's going to have to be answering threats every turn. So whether it's the Druid or Rogue, going to have to be really hoping for UCCU to once again find his threats in the wrong order, because if Aggro Shaman gets going, we've all played it on the ladder. We know what can happen.
And Druid it is for Staz as we get into game number 4 of this elimination match. Totem Golem, one of the most important cards for the Aggro Shaman. It's very important you're able to get in early minion damage, and Totem Golem is a minion that's very difficult for Druid to deal with because it's so large for so little cost.
Interesting though, with the Living Roots and the Wrath, there is some play. It won't necessarily be ideal, but it's possible.
Yeah, Staz does have the ability to actually deal with this Totem Golem, so very good spot for him in just these early turns.
But he's going to be frustrated to have to use the Wrath for 3 damage, given that he has no play for turn 3. It just now draws into a turn 4 play.
I don't know if you're frustrated. I think you're just happy you can kill a Totem Golem.
Sure, that's fair.
You're happy you're just not getting beat for 3 a turn.
Well, that was definitely the only 2-mana card that would have dealt with Totem Golem. Still has some board presence that answers the Leper Gnome, if we're to see it.
Yeah, Leper Gnome is, you know, something that UCCU pretty much just might as well play here. It's going to die to I was going to say it might die to the Hero Power, but it's actually just going to die to the Sapling because Staz does pick up Wild Growth to curve out.
Got to say, better than expected start for the Druid.
Yeah, I mean, the Druid actually needs a 2-card combo of Living Roots into Wrath to not get killed by that Totem Golem, and he had it.
I think the Hearthstone term is sometimes lucky.
Worked out all right. And now the Bear comes down one turn ahead of schedule thanks to that Wild Growth. UCCU can remove it. He's got a variety of options here is exactly how he wants to go about it.
Now, he has Divine Shield on this minion, and you think about the Druid deck, there isn't really many targets for Earthshock, so is there validity to just Earthshock and sending some damage face?
You can Earthshock. I wouldn't be surprised to maybe see Earthshock into Totem Golem, if only because that allows him to... Totem Golem would just die to the Bear. What am I talking about?
Sure.
The Earthshock would potentially let him attack face. You might see Crackle just try and get lucky. But the Bear is definitely stymieing UCCU's plans pretty significantly right now, so he wants to get rid of it.
Like to see if he uses the Earthshock this turn. Does have a lot of different lines of play, as you were mentioning.
If he Crackles and he rolls at least a 4, he can just trade the Divine Shield for the Bear. And that does allow him to play Totem Golem.
Three good results here.
All right, five. So he can actually, if he wanted to, he could just go ahead and attack into it. He could have used Earthshock to kill it, but then he couldn't play the Totem Golem as well. So he's hoping to fade a swipe this turn, and there's a swipe right off the top of Staz's deck.
That's exactly what he was looking for.
We might see a Force of Nature here. It's another option. Force of Nature does clear both of these minions, and it's more expensive, so it's harder to fit into a later turn as well.
And does it change? Like, we're thinking about turns where you have to use Force of Nature for removal. If you have a swipe in your hand or a Force of Nature, how do you handle, say, a Feral Spirits, for example? Is it about the same?
Yeah. Well, Force of Nature is a bit better against Feral Spirits because Force of Nature plus your hero power can kill both halves
that
of Feral Spirits.
That is an 8-mana combo.
It is. But also, the swipe lines up well, lines up better with other cards that you can play in the same turn. For instance, here he can also swipe and get to use his hero power in the same turn. So that has some attractiveness as well, given that gaining armor is quite valuable against the burst damage of the Shaman.
Elects to use the swipe. We thought about cycling the Force of Nature, but we'll hold on to that for a future turn.
And now UCCU, he has just these relatively low impact spells here. And this is not where he wants to be. He had a pretty good start, but Staz had the perfect answers. And now he just totems. So he really needs to find something high impact. That's, speaking of high impact, Staz finds Ancient of Lore here, digging deeper into his deck. He's still at 27 health.
And we were sitting back talking about the frustrations of Tempo Mage and why we might not see it in tournament play. This is a big draw, though.
Oh, yes. This allows, with the Rockbiter weapon, allows UCCU to remove the Ancient and get 5 damage to Staz's face. This is exactly what he's looking to draw.
I have an axe.
Is he actually just going face? He's actually not even going to kill it? Oh, wow. That's aggressive. One thing in this matchup is that the Shaman does need to worry about the possibility of just dying. And given that Staz did pick up a bunch of cards, that bear is going to get in the way. And now Staz is just trying to present as many threats as he can. Arcane Golem, all right, he can Earthshock this bear and just go to the face. Yeah, actually, I think UCCU was correct to just go face there. He is facing an opponent who just drew a bunch of cards. He's not going to be able to win a resource war. It's pretty clear that Staz will be playing big minions each turn.
11 damage reach if we see Earthshock, Lightning Bolt, and the Arcane Golem to the face along with the weapons, if I did my math correctly.
Yeah, right now, he can potentially Earthshock, send 4 damage in. If he does play that Totem Golem, or the Arcane Golem, rather, yeah, he can get the 7, I believe it is 10 damage right now. Given the mana he has available. He's overloaded for 2 right now, so he would be able to do 10 damage right now, getting Staz down to just 7 life with Lightning Bolt in hand.
You're right, and even Lothar would not be able to ice that out. He'll have access to the 6 mana next turn, and with Lothar it would still be playable along with the weapon. So yep, loads up the Lightning Bolt.
Well, here, the crazy thing is that Staz has that Lothar. This is an interesting spot because both Lothar and the Ancient of War are both pretty attractive. I think you feel like you might have to go with Lothar simply because any combination of 2 spells does kill you.
It's also worth knowing that there's 4 guaranteed damage from the weapon, which is not a spell, but also guaranteed damage if you go for Lothar, so...
Yep. So UCCU is overloaded for 1, so he will have 8 mana next turn. That means he can't cast Lava Burst if you play Lothar, so he could only cast Crackle or Lightning Bolt for damage spells. And if Staz plays the Lothar and uses his hero power, he actually goes to 7, which means that even the weapon and Lightning Bolt does not kill him. Oh, actually, no, it's exactly lethal. Never mind.
And it's worth knowing that with the Ancient of War, he could also hero power and go to 7.
My math is...
You're 100% guaranteed to lock out 4. Math is not always our strong suit.
I was just like, oh no, you could do that. It's like, wait, no, that's
wait,
not quite
what is he
right.
doing now?
It looks like he's thinking of 8. No, he's going to Lothar. Did he not attack? Okay, he's going to Lothar and ping this, but actually, yes, this is... He didn't hero power, and he is locking out all the spells. UCCU, he does have that Doomhammer and Lightning Bolt to the face, and he is going to take down Staz. 3-1.
And we knew there were ways he could live, but there's no way to know for sure. You have to play around so many different permutations if you're against an aggro shaman at this low life total, and it's going to be Staz, the first person eliminated. UCCU from Taiwan stays in the tournament.
Yeah, definitely picked up a clutch win there with his shamanic that had struggled so far, but he will have more opportunities to play it as he is going to be moving on to the elimination matches tomorrow.
Fourth time's the charm for aggro shaman. It had a lot of poor targets, and I wanted to actually talk to you while we have a moment here. I mean, the big decks were the Rogue and specifically the aggro shaman. Is it, given that we all saw how many control decks, was it too much bravado to bring in these decks, given that we really heavily expected a control meta?
I think it may just have been a misread of the metagame. You don't want to bring a deck like Oil Rogue when you expect people to be playing Control Warrior. It's just not a matchup that you're going to be able to usually win. So, Staz, he came in but just didn't get the metagame that he was hoping for.
That means that UCCU will be facing Dione in the next round. But for now, let's pass it over to Doa, who's standing fireside with UCCU.
Hey guys, I am here with UCCU, and UCCU, you survived. So coming into today, things weren't going so well. You lost your match in game number, or in day number one, rather. You were able to take it today. Were you worried at all coming into today that you wouldn't make it?
He said, you lost your first day, so you came to play today, how are you feeling? I'm very
worried. Yeah, because I'm afraid if I lose, I'm going to
go out. He's pretty afraid, because if he lost, he will be gone.
Yeah, I suppose. Well, you're not gone yet. You get to come back tomorrow. So you mentioned before that at first when you started playing Hearthstone, your parents weren't quite on board with it. But now you're starting to win. You survived today. You made it to the Asia-Pacific Championships. Do you think they're watching at home right now?
Yeah, definitely. They are watching right now.
Okay, how about your cat? Do you think your cat is watching as well?
你的猫有在看吗?
应该在睡觉吧.
The cat should be sleeping right now.
Oh, okay. All right. The cat sleeps. Your parents are watching Hearthstone. All right, great. So you brought Aggro Shaman today. That's not a deck that's been quite as popular in tournaments lately. What made you think that it would do the job here?
你今天带了嘲讽萨满，那这不是非常
大家喜欢用的牌，那你认为你今天带这个牌来的用意何在呢？其实我带的是快攻萨满，那我主要是针对兵法跟德鲁伊去下去做带牌的。So
he brought the fast shaman right now, but the strategy here is for his druid to get the match.
All right. Well, it's working, whatever it is. So you're making it on to tomorrow. Congratulations again. That does it for me and UCCU here at the interview station. Let's go back to the sidebar where TJ, D2, and Frodan are standing by.
Thank you very much, Doa. I'm here at the sidebar with the double Dans, D2 and Frodan. And that was an interesting matchup, and I saw a tweet featured earlier that I think that whole series lasted about as long as a single game from the series prior to that. So we're going to get right into it and talk about some of the deck choices here. Both these players have struggled with some of these decks, and Staz being one of them with Tempo Mage. So D2, what are your thoughts on Tempo Mage? We haven't seen it too much across the other championships.
Right, I think there's a reason for that, obviously, because even though Freeze Mage can be a bit polarizing, it does have very good matchups. It's very good at, you know, dealing with aggressive decks. Tempo Mage a bit more, you know, not reliable, I would say. Mm-hmm. So
inconsistent.
Exactly. And especially when you're running a very greedy version, that the one that Staz is running, you know, having those double Ethereal Conjurers, having the Ragnaros in there, you saw a lot of times he basically couldn't do anything because his hand was just so clunky.
And Dan, why are these greedy choices not the best for, you know, the type of lineup that Staz is trying to bring here?
Oh, I think one thing that you have to really look at is Tempo Mage. You usually bring it to do one thing, and it's to be extremely aggressive and fast and snipe decks that can't punish it. So when you're losing against Druid, which is the matchup that you should be winning, it's like it feels extremely bad to be in that scenario. So the fact is he also has a really greedy list, which makes it conveniently better against slower control decks, gives him more range against things, you know, like the Warlocks or the controlled warriors that you often see. But the reality is he ends up facing against a really aggressive lineup. Cards like Ragnaros is not going to really help you do much against things like the Shaman generally. And so in this case, I'm not really feeling the greedy list. I felt like Staz, in the end, was trying to a little bit too hard to get ahead of the curve and just didn't play the Tempo Mage's strengths. It's not necessarily benefiting off of a card like Ragnaros a lot of times. It's benefiting off of building a board preemptively and leveraging those minions on board for a win.
Well, great points. Let's jump into one of the games where
Tempo Mage was sort of featured here. And this is actually a line of play that UCCU was making. And when you're playing against the Tempo Mage, you sort of have to make plays sometimes that are, you know, tempo-oriented. So, D2, walk me through this play and why UCCU decides to... the play that UCCU decides
Sorry,
to make.
Man, I was overtaken by passion there. I was ready for D2's extremely good explanation. Go ahead. Sorry about that.
D2?
Oh, sorry about that. I thought you were talking back to TJ again. Anyway, sorry about that. He does go for the Azure Drake here, and then he goes immediately into that coin and the rat to get the card. Obviously, getting a card is pretty nice here, but going for the tempo against the tempo mage is usually superior because as long as you can take the tempo away from them, you can secure the game, especially as, you know, a slower deck, slightly slower deck as the Druid. You want to keep those minions onto the board. And so basically, UCCU, I mean, I've been in that situation as well as a player. You basically, you decide beforehand what you're going to do, and then you kind of tunnel vision on that. And once he picked up the innervate, wasn't able to kind of pivot.
Yeah, pivoting, I think, is the right word there. And the other option would have been to innervate out the swipe to make it a clear board, have double creatures. And it really came back to punish him towards the end of the game there. And Dan, looking at some UCCU's lineup in general as well, we saw Aggro Shaman, which is a deck that we really have not seen much of, and the decks that we have seen, or the players that we have seen play that deck, have struggled a lot with it. Why do you think Aggro Shaman's struggling, especially since a lot of players considered it one of the strongest decks coming into the Winter Championships?
You said they consider the Aggro Shaman one of the stronger decks?
Talking to a lot of players, yeah, especially Chalky, which is a good example.
How it worked out for him.
Yeah. But why do you think it's not working out too well?
I think Aggro Shaman has really powerful matchups, specifically against control warriors that really can't keep up with the pace of it, really good against freeze mages that you can benefit off Doomhammer threatening, and even against secret paladins that can't keep up with the pace. However, people aren't really playing these things as commonly as you expect them to be. Some people do bring the freeze mages, but people are not even bringing secret paladin to this entire tournament. They're actually doing something else completely different to it. Some people are even bringing a classic demon handlock and murloc paladin. These are the really unusual stuff. So as much as Aggro Shaman might be decent on a ladder result, you can't always just trust the ranked play as being the litmus test of what you should bring to a tournament. One thing that you can really see that benefits of a lot of players is the practice environment. Yeah. UCCU is a player that doesn't really have as many practice partners as other people who are really well established and have a lot of teams or organizations supporting them. So it doesn't really surprise me that some of these independent thinkers might think that the Shaman might be really powerful, but he also has a completely different lineup too. He's taking more of an approach to target things like Freeze Mage. He has the Druid, he has the Aggro Shaman, which happens to work out in this match. But moving forward, I still feel like he's in a decent position relative to what the other people brought in the field because of decks like Freeze Mage is so prominent amongst the people who still survive in the tournament.
Yeah, we'll see if he can sort of capitalize on some of those control matchups as he does survive to play another day. But we do have one more match left to go in day number two of the Asia Pacific Winter Championship. It is going to be between Naviut and Sogi. But before we jump into that match, let's take a look at some of the highlights from those last games.